This is my brand new 1450 Stabycraft. I'm about to show you exactly how I've set it up and what this incredible little boat can do.
Oh yes, Kingy, got it. There you go. See how the cast platform works.
I've got one little pump and I've cleverly designed it so it can run a tuna tube, a wash down, and a live bait tank is a 3-in-1. Now another thing with the bait board, it is removable, but you can have it in different positions. It's a Yamaha 4-stroke. It squirts this boat along at 28 knots. And of course it's got that legendary Stabycraft ride. Turns like it is on rails. When you come down to a marina, it's hard not to get excited looking at all the boats. I mean, if you love boats, it's just so awesome checking out how they're set up. And I've worked on big game fishing boats like these ones behind me, and I've used that experience as well as my experience on trailer boats, big and small trailer boats, and these have helped me design my Stabycraft boats, from great big boats like the 2750 to little wee ones. But even on a very modest budget with some clever thinking, you can get some crazy good fishing features on a little boat. A little boat that can do almost anything, and none more so than this one here. This is my brand new 1450 Stabycraft that I've set up myself at home, and I'm about to show you exactly how I've set it up and what this incredible little boat can do. But for all of those exciting fishing missions to happen, you've got to get your boat to the water. And once again, I run with a Hoskins trailer. One, because they're Kiwi made, they use Kiwi made parts and they put them together right. Now in the case of this trailer, this is a very small basic trailer. Important points are it's steel, not aluminium. Aluminium trailers can crack the stresses of going along the road. Double dip galved, so it's not going to give you any problems. You don't want any hassles when you're going fishing. Now the trailer's all adjustable, so you can get the balance of your boat right. Everything from the winch pillar to the axles can all be moved. And one of the neat things I like about this trailer is they've set them up so the boat sits as low as possible, so you can reach in and out of the boat just to grab stuff at home, and they're easy to climb in and out of. Good, strong, solid guard, not plastic ones, so you can stand on them to get in and out. And here, nice open wheels. Just makes wash up really easy. Get the salt off them and they'll last forever. Good quality trailer, it's a Hoskins. So right now I'm going to take you for a walkthrough of this boat from bow to stern. And we're going to start up here with this casting platform. So we've got this seating arrangement so you can sit people on either side, which joins seamlessly into the casting platform. So plenty of room to get up here and cast. Now you'll see this is the first addition that I've added to the boat. I've started from pretty much a standard boat and I've had this bar fabricated up that lifts in and out. Now this works as an incredibly great casting rail. I'm going to cover this in more detail later on in the fishing setup, but right now we're going to carry on through the boat anchoring. So plenty of room underneath the casting platform. I've got 100 meters of warp, chain and anchor that goes out over the front. And you'll see how we've brought the bow rail around nice and low out of the way, and it runs the anchor straight down onto a little roller at the front and a cleat where we cleat it off. Now we've got this rod rack up here, which is also a step to get onto the casting platform. When I've got my rail in here, it drops into two of the rod holders, but I've still got room for two more rods that I can grab quick access when I'm up here casting. Now this bit, I love it, the floor. Right from where I'm standing right to the very transom is one piece of floor, checker plate floor, which is uninterrupted, nothing attached to it. We've got the seat that's hanging on a pedestal out off the side of the boat that cantilevers out, and we've got the ICTEC bin, which of course isn't connected to the deck. It can slide around on my tube matting and I can position that wherever I want some extra ballast, or it's the seat for my passenger with, or passengers with two squabs on it. Now coming back down here, past these outriggers, which no doubt you would have noticed, again, I've set these up myself in conjunction with the Evolution 360 rod holders. They're quite incredible, but again, these will be covered more in the fishing setup. Right now, we're just gonna take a look at the console. So nice clean Perspex screen, just to keep everything clean and tidy. When you're sitting down, it does actually break the wind. When you're steaming along, sitting on your seat here, I've put the remotes on this side just to keep them out of the way. It was tempting to have them on the outside of the console, so people like to quite often be able to operate the boat while they're moving around. The trouble with that is it's at a point where it can be knocked. So you can have your passengers knock the boat in and out of gear, or you can be running along and they can floor it. So out here, it's nice and out of the way, and the boat's small enough that I can be fishing here and still reach the Yamaha controls nice and easy. Now, speaking of controls, you will notice there is not a whole lot on this dash. I've wanted to keep this boat very clean and true to the form that it's a very simple boat. With the open flooring, nothing attached to the deck, it's very easy to clean. I didn't want a complicated boat with a whole lot of gear on it. Now, the only switches I've got are for my fish finder, which technically I don't even need a switch for, that could be hardwired. And I've got my bait tank pump. Now, my bait tank pump is a 3-in-1. I've got one little pump and I've cleverly designed it so it can run a tuna tube, a washdown, and a live bait, and that will be covered again in the fishing setup. I'm pretty chuffed with the way I set that one up. And the only other switch is the only bit of customization I've done to this dash, and I've just added a couple of USB ports here. And that's because these days we're using our phone for SST charts, music, playlists, all of that sort of stuff. So it's nice to be able to charge up your accessories. And I've got these Yamaha gauges here. So that's the dash setup. I'll cover the DB9 a little bit later on. That's an incredible unit. It's got Furuno's patented proprietary blue beam technology inside of it, which gives you things like Res Boost, AccuFish, and a whole bunch of technology, which basically gives you a more true and clearer image. The market asks for all of that tech into a small, affordable unit, and they have done it with this DB9. It is straight out of the box, turn it on, put it on auto, and it does some incredible stuff. Coming further back, I've got the Stabycraft Railblazer cup holders, which get used for phones, sinkers, all sorts of stuff. They're just really good secure storage, and they've been known to be used for the odd refreshment or two. And now another customization that I've done. The standard boat comes with a bait board on the side. I wanted something that I could operate at the back. Now, one of the things that I've done with this boat is I've got it set up so it's interchangeable and I can have it in different fishing modes depending on what I'm gonna do. So stand by to see the different modes. This mode here, with obviously my big gear, my Talica 50s on, is how I might have it set up if I was going sword fishing. Now, this is a boat that is legitimately capable of going out and catching swordfish to coming right inshore and fishing in half a meter or less fly fishing up on the flats, and that's the way that I've set it up. So, we're going to show you that very soon. We're going to just come down here in the transom, because if we are going out wide, we're going to need some fuel. So the Yamaha tanks, I've set it up so I can take two tanks down the transom with the battery box in the middle. So that gives me close to 50 litres of fuel, which gives me more than enough range to do a day's game fishing, like, and going well out wide as well. But with this battery box, I've got the X-Side battery in there. I've always run my X-Sides just because they're proper marine batteries set up for marine. Don't cut corners and get a cheap battery. You just don't want to be out there and get stuck with a dud battery. And to keep my battery maintained, I've set it up so with one of these Hella waterproof plugs down here. Now, that allows me to plug my electric reel straight in there, which is great when I want to use an electric reel. But when I get home, I've just put the same adapter on the end of my C-Tech battery charger, and I can just plug that straight in when I'm sitting at home, and it's going to keep my battery maintained and topped up. Also down the back here, you'll notice we've got internal bungs. So you get any water in the boat, you can just take that bung out from the inside and the water's going to drain out, and it's not going to come flooding back in because we've got our external duckbill scuppers. And also down here, these cutouts, which gives us storage underneath the seats where I just keep a little bit of gear. We've got the helm chair here, back folds up and down. I have it down quite a lot, it just keeps things clean and out of the way. Obviously it's up when I'm sitting in it, and at the back, my new 50 horsepower Yamaha, and I've put a permatrim on this. Because I've loaded this boat to the back, I want an extra bit of lift at the back. And the thing with a permatrim above anything else is it allows me to plane at low speeds. I can have this boat planing at about 11.5-12 knots, which means if it cuts up rough, I don't have to come home in displacement mode. I'm using less fuel and I'm just sitting above those waves quite nicely. And for me, having that trim control is the biggest advantage of running the permatrim. So there you go, that's our walkthrough from bow to stern of my 1450 Stabycraft. Now for the bit that I'm sure you've all been waiting for, the fishing setup. Now the first mode we're going to take a look at in the fishing setup is game fishing mode. Now I've set this boat up so it can be a bona fide game fishing boat, and I've done most of the modifications myself at home. Now the first thing I've done is made sure I've got a safe, secure place to store my rods when I'm steaming that's out of the way. So I've just increased the width of the transom here to give me enough room to put in these Evolution rod holders. Now these ones are the fixed, they're not rotating, and that is because they're primarily for rod storage. Now I've removed the bait board, and I'm going to show you how adjustable the bait board is when we look at the other modes, but at the moment I've not got it on board because I don't need it. I'm going to be trolling lures, or I'm going to be doing bait and switch, in which case I'll be using my tuna tube and my live bait tank. But this is nice and low, nice and secure. Now, when we get out, after steaming out, we have our rods here. We've got to put our outriggers out. Now, this is just the Evolution 360 rod holder. It's the vertical one, and I've modified my riggers to lock in perfectly. Now, I can swing that to any position I want my outrigger, depending on whether I'm trolling baits or lures, or even on the sea conditions. And when I'm happy, I just let go. Now, that just locks in position. And I've just added the addition to these other rod holders here. I've taken one of the screws out, and I've just gone and got a stainless eyelet from the hardware store. And this is the perfect place for me to clip on my halyard. So I've got nice, easy access to my outrigger halyard. And then with my riggers out, which literally takes seconds, I can get all of my rods dropped into position, ready for trolling. Take them out of their storage area, and they sit in position. And now these ones here are the angled ones, and allows me to rotate my rod holders and get my rod tips exactly where I want them. For my rigger rods, I like to run them at 90 degrees, and then I tip my rod backwards. Now this here, if we look down the line, gives my rod tip a nice clear line back. So when that lure goes up the rigger, if I get a bite, it's not going to foul on this back one. And that's important when you're in a small boat and all your lures are running relatively close together. And you can see the way that I've set it up, they're just going to drop into position, and here I am ready to troll, and I've got access to my helm and all of my rods from this one position here. Now with the size of this boat and it being so easy to manage, you can quite comfortably go big game fishing by yourself. Now the question remains, how are you going to fight the fish? So I leave all of the rods either where they are, if they're on the starboard side, or at the back. This really is the only rod that has to be cleared away on this port side. And then I just take the rigger, I click it on here, pull the rigger out, and I can just spin it round, and it lays beautifully down beside the seat there. And that gives me, with this rod, once I've got my fish on, literally from this corner all the way around to the bow, and of course I can stay down by the helm, and this is my position right here where I'm going to fight the fish. And it takes seconds to clear that rigger out of the way, and I've got all of this room to work with. If you want to see exactly how I've set up the outriggers so I can run tag lines, clips, different sort of dropbacks for different sorts of game fishing, we've got the full setup that you can check out right here at ultimatefishing.tv. Just use the search word outriggers and you should find it, no worries. Now just up the front of the boat, this is quite often where my passenger will sit, or even if I'm solo game fishing, I still bring out the chili bin because, well, it acts as a seat for a passenger. If I don't have a passenger, the old Isotec's the perfect place to keep a nice few cold crisp cans of Swordfish Mojo to help you pass the time when you're game fishing. But up here, casting rail. While I'm not going to be out fly fishing, when I'm game fishing, I still have this cast rail on because it's a great handle when the boat's rocking around, particularly if it gets rough, you've got a great holding point as you're moving around the boat. Now, I do a wee bit of casting when I'm out, and that's namely if I'm live baiting and I see some skipjack tuna, I can cast a little wee lure and I can stock up my tuna tube with a fresh skipjack tuna by casting from up here. And the other one is I always carry the big set, the Stella, with a big stick bait in case I see some yellowfin. So it's all ready to go for whatever fish that I come across. And then when we come down the back here, this is where all the action happens. Typically, if we're trolling lures, I'll have four rods out. If we're running baits, I'll only have two. or I might be running my electric reels with teasers and have two pitch baits. Whatever the case, I can operate everything, my teaser reels, my rigger rods, my flatline rods, all from this one position, and reach the helm and reach the remotes, so I can do everything from this cockpit area here. And I can tell you, with this setup, this boat is incredibly exciting when you get amongst the marlin and a little wee boat like this.
Look at them, that's all marlin. Oh shit, see that bite. Look at them feed, look at them feed. There must be 20 or 30 marlin or more. Holy shit, look at them feed. Oh, his head come out of the water to eat. Here he comes on this lure.
So basically, I've got all the gear to cover all my game fishing scenarios, from casting top water to trolling lures, which is the configuration that I've got now. If I'm trolling live baits, I'll quite often only troll one live bait or maybe two live baits. If I'm bait and switching, I change these out for my electric reels and I can tow some teasers, and I usually have a dead bait and a live bait ready to pitch. So pretty much everything that we can do on these great big launches, I've set this boat up so we can do it all here. And we can reach the dash, helm, remotes, all from this one point. Now, one of the clever things that I've done with that just one little wee pump that we've got here for my live bait tank, I've got it set up so I can do all those kinds of fishing that we've spoken about. Now, just in behind the fuel tank here, we've just got that one small live bait tank pump, and that's fed by a Venturi feed which comes up through the hull, which provides positive pressure to the pump all of the time. In fact, while you're steaming, you don't even need the pump running. You just need the valve open. Now, that feeds this bit of pipe here. Now, what this bit of pipe here is some 18 mil garden hose. So I've just got this, again, from the hardware store. It's thicker than your standard garden hose. And I've got these extra large hose attachments on. Now, if I'm just out and I'm not game fishing and I just want to be live baiting, I just clip that onto my live bait tank. Flick the switch on, my pump is now feeding my live bait tank. But now I want to get some tuna and I want to keep my live baits alive. I simply unhook it from the live bait tank, clip it onto the tuna tube, and then the overflow from the tuna tube I clip back onto the live bait tank. So now I've got water coming up the tuna tube, keeping my tuna alive. The overflow comes out, feeds in here my tank full of mackerel, which I've had up to 20 mackerel alive all day, along with my skipjack tuna that's sitting in the tube, and it all functions off that one pump. Now, at the end of the day, when I want to clean up, I grab this bit here and I can unclip, clip that on, and at the end of the day, just that one bait tank pump that also operates my tuna tube makes a nice little wash down, so we can have a wee clean up.
Awesome, eh?
It is the 3-in-1 setup that took a little bit of thinking at home and a trip to the plumbing supply store, and now for the moderate cost of one little wee pump, which in this case comes standard with the boat, I'm able to have a tuna tube, live bait tank, and a washdown hose. And all of this setup allows me to do some bona fide game fishing that we would do on a big boat. Now, the next mode we're going to have a look at is the general inshore fishing and diving mode, which I've got the boat nice and clean, so no outriggers, and any gear that I'm bringing on board, I just use a nice, decent tackle bag, and I just load it up with the tackle that I'm going to be using. And that sort of sits generally nicely underneath the console there, out of the way, where I've got quick and easy access to the tackle that I'm going to be using. I've got my bait board, of course, if I'm going to be bait fishing, but it's also a great stable platform. Compartments for your lures and everything. Now, I just found this plastic tray online. Now, the thing that I'm looking for is that I've got this nice big drain at the front here, and this surface is higher than the front lip, so it means I can skin and cut fish nice and easily on here. All of the crap falls down into this drain, and I've just added a little bit of plastic pipe here which runs all of the yucky guts and everything overboard. Now, out here on the swim step, I quite often put a rubber bucket, so if I've got a burley pot or anything, I can pop it in a rubber bucket outside here, and it just stops all of that crap coming into the boat. Now, that's if I'm fishing with bait. Now, another point while we're down the back here, tuna tube. I'm not going to need that if I'm snapper fishing or even fly fishing up on the flats. So when I don't want my tuna tube, I just unclip it, clip my live bait tank on, and I've got a couple of Railblazer starports here, and there you go. That's my tuna tube. No use taking that with me if I don't need it. That can stay at home. And now we can't talk about fishing setup on this boat without covering these rod holders, which again, just like my big boat, have changed the whole setup of the boat, the Evolution 360 rod holders. Now they swivel 360 degrees, so you can have your rod tip pointing wherever you like. And it means you have to have less rod holders to be able to do more things. So I've got these ones across the back, which are primarily for storage or if I'm stray lining or bait fishing. And I've got two angled up the sides, and then I've got two vertical here, which double as vertical rod storage and also as outrigger bases. So for the cost of a pair of rotating rod holders, you've got rotating, fully adjustable outrigger mounts, and you've got a place to chuck your rods. Now, another great thing about the setup of this boat, with this casting platform that joins beautifully into this sort of side seat here, what they've cleverly done is they've made a cutout underneath the combing here. So things like your fly rods, things that you just never have storage for, can slide in from front to back. And it's always been a problem, particularly on a small boat, is where do you put your fly rod? It's a great big long thing. It's a sensitive, expensive bit of equipment. Well, look at that. That lays beautifully up under there, out of the way. And that goes for tag poles, gaff poles, anything that's long that you struggle for storage for, just by having this cutout open at the front, nice and easy. Also makes for nice, easy cleaning. And same as spear guns. Another thing that you always struggle to find a space for on the boat. Not on this little boat. The tips of the spear guns can sit out there beautifully. And speaking of spear fishing, how good is this open platform for when you want to go for a dive? Load all your gear on, load your mates on, and just rip out and do it. And that's what this boat's designed for, just to make everything easy. Now, another thing with the bait board, of course, it is removable, but it's not just removable to take off the boat. You can have it in different positions. Starboard side bait position, where I want better access to my live bait tank and more fishing room on the port side. The center bait position, which gives me two rod holders either side for my big game fishing reels and a nice platform for me to rig baits for marlin, swordfish, snapper, anything I like. Port side bait board position gives me better access on my starboard side when I'm sitting at the helm and I'm swiveling my chair around to fish out of this corner. All of this is out of the road, and we will note on the end here, I've just added this little magnetic tool holder. It's a Rapala magnetic tool holder, and it holds my knife, some scissors, and some Rapala angler's pliers. Now they all stay there, nice and out of the way. They're magnetic, so things don't rattle around. The beauty of them being plastic, you don't get any rattle, you don't get any rust, and you get very little vibration. Which also allows me, if I want to, is to remove my casting bar. So this is just a bit of stainless bar that I've had fabricated up. And by using the exact same spacings, I can have this down the back if I choose. In which case, it gives me an extra bit of support rail down the back and gives me extra rod holders and space up the front. Or I can take my bait board all the way to the front where it drops into those same holders. And now I've got myself a little bit of extra space, a table up here to have all my selection of lures, and I can keep the back nice and open and clean. So just by having those same spacings for the bait board and the cast bar, it gives me four different positions for my bait board and two different positions for my casting bar. Now we're going to take a look at the casting bar back up the front, because that has changed the whole function and the usable space in this boat incredibly for that one bar. Let's take a look. Now this casting platform that we've got up here, which is a great space, really would only be usable about 10% of the time without this casting bar that I've had fabricated. And that's basically because it's not often this calm that you can stand up here without holding on, particularly once you've got a fishing rod in your hand and you're really casting out some lures. What that does is I've made it at the perfect height just to stick your bum on. Now you can really lever back against it, you can select your rod, and you can cast. So you can hold on with one hand if you like, but mostly you really don't need to. You can stand up here and cast all day, and you've still got that room for a rod either side. But honestly, being up here, I've caught a whole bunch of fish, and I find that everyone I bring on this boat gravitates to this spot that I am right now, and they're in this position that I'm in right now. And it's all down to having this removable casting bar that I've never taken off the boat from the moment that I put it on. It is that handy.
Oh yes, Kingy. Oh, big one, big one. Yeah, he's still on me, Got him. And there you go. See how the cast platform works. Oh. Got some drag on that bastard. I love doing these sneaky little casts when we're supposed to be doing a boat review video. We are reviewing the boat. You've got to put it through its paces, right? And this is how you do it. Oh, look at him. You go. There you go. That's a nice, fat, fighting, fit kingfish from up here in the shallows. And that's just, again, a perfect demonstration of how easy it is to just pop up the front here. I saw the water was clean at the harbour entrance. Said to the boys, there'll be a kingfish here. And just by having the right gear right here, in its spot, loaded, ready to go, I was able to jump up here, a couple of casts later, and we've got a nice kingfish.
This thing really is a pocket-sized battleship.